Hey serverless friends, welcome to this first Azure Functions challenge. This is an experiment I'm doing. So next to the beginner content for Azure Functions University, I'll be creating some challenges now and then. And those challenges are mostly suitable for people who have some experience with Azure Functions already. In this case, it's about notification challenge. So the use case is, whenever your application sends out alerts, you can usually involve a webhook in it, so it can post an alert to HTTP endpoint. And we will write an application that can respond to such an alert and then notify people which are on duty and have to respond to these alerts and make sure to fix your application. So this use case is based on a real life situation. I helped a fellow MVP a few weeks back, and he had questions about this solution. So I pointed him in the direction of Dribbble functions, and we made it quite a nice example use case out of this. And it is actually working in production right now. So the idea of these challenges is that they are really practical, real-life scenarios where we combine different parts of Azure Functions. So we combine different bindings, or we combine different Azure services to make it as real-life as possible. If you go to this link, so AZFunk Challenge, you will end up here on this page. This case, it's specific to Dribbble functions. So I've created the Git repo, Dribbble functions use cases. And right now it contains only one use case, and that's the notify support use case. So very briefly, the idea is that we write a function app, and that function app responds to an HTTP trigger and has some information about an alert. Then it needs to get information from the support about support contacts. So it needs some names and phone numbers, stuff like that. And then it needs to iterate over the people in the support contact group. So starting with the first one, it needs to send a notification. In this case, we'll be using phone numbers. We'll send a notification. We then wait for that person to have received that message or phone call. And if he received a message within a given time limit, then we are satisfied because the support person has received the notification, and that person can respond to the alert, so we're safe. If the person did not respond within a certain time limit, then we will try to notify that person again. So that's this loop. But we only do that for, let's say, three times. So we'll try to notify one person, the first person, three times within this time limit. If you reach the maximum number of notifications we try to send for one person, in this case three, then we try to go to the next person in the contact list. So we first need to know, okay, is there another support contact we can reach? If no, well, then we just stop, nothing to be done. But if there is a next person, then we select that next support contact and we go through this same loop again. So what we want is a flexible solution that works with any given number of support contacts in this list, which we will read from table storage, by the way. And we want the maximum number of notifications to be a configurable value in your application settings. And we also want this time limit, so when a person need to respond, we also want that as a configurable value. So let's say for one person, we need to we want to wait maximum 5 minutes before we go to the next person to try to send a notification. And so within 5 minutes, we want to send a notification to this first person three times. All right, so let's go into a bit more detail about this support challenge, notify support challenge. Again, I have the same diagram. I've got some prerequisites listed here. Let me briefly go through that. So this is about creating a solution in .NET Core. But to be honest, you can also create this using JavaScript. because we're using durable functions, and durable functions also works with JavaScript, TypeScript. So if you want to do it in .NET, you have to make sure that you're using .NET Core 3.1. I will be using VS Code for this challenge. So that's why I have the VS Code and the extensions listed here. You also need a REST client to make sure you can trigger the notification yourself, and also the callback. And it's very useful to have the Azure Storage Explorer, so you can manage your support contact list in table storage. I'm on Windows, and therefore I can use the Azure Storage Emulator for table storage and also for Drupal functions. More on that later. If you're not on Windows, then you have to use an extra storage account in Azure. The final prerequisite is really optional. I'm starting to use a bit of Code Tour, which is an extension in VS Code, because you can use it very nicely to go through your code and make annotations in your code to make it very readable and explain things about the solution. But I'm just about starting to use it, so you don't really need it right now. And when you start with this use case, of course you can clone this repo, that's fine, but it's always better to create your own workspace and start from scratch, because you'll definitely learn more about that. Let's get back to the challenge. So the scope of this first video is I'll explain the challenge. I'll explain a bit of the theory of all the components you need to solve the challenge, but I won't be solving or showing the solution of the challenge in this video. So I'll give you all the ingredients you need to solve it yourself, and then I'll create a next video. And in the next video, I'll walk you through the solution I've made. What I will do now is go over the components you will need. So it's mostly about Drupal functions. There is some other components which are used, like Azure Functions HTTP trigger and table binding, but that content is already taken care of in some Azure Functions University lessons, which I'll be referring to. But I'll cover some Drupal functions parts, not in its complete form, but some very specific parts which you can use to solve this challenge. Then there are some additional requirements for this solution, which you need to follow to make sure you create it and make sure it checks all of the boxes. I won't go through that into detail. You can read it on your own. But what I'll do now is cover this dual function theory. I have some other videos about Drupal functions already, so if you really want more detail, I would advise you to go to those videos. But for the majority of the part, I think what I'll add now in this video will be enough to get going, especially if you already have a bit of knowledge about Drupal functions, then it should be fine. So if you haven't heard about Drupal functions yet, or haven't used it yet, Drupal functions is an extension on top of Azure functions, and you can install it as an additional package. And it allows you to write workflows as code. And yeah, for developers, that's, I think, a good thing, because we are very used to writing code, and we usually prefer to define things in code instead of visual designers. So there are lots of different workflow solutions. So there's also things like Logic Apps, for instance, or Power Automate. So those are fine if you're more visually oriented. But if you like code, then Drupal functions is really ideal to create your workflows or your orchestrations in code. And the nice thing about it is that the state of those workflows is persisted to storage, to Azure Storage account. And that enables it to have really long running workflows. So you're not limited to, let's say, the maximum 10 minute execution time of just your function. You can have really long running workflows, like hours, days, months. There's no limit. So That allows you to have some different application patterns. So for instance, you can chain different function calls in your orchestration. You can also execute function calls in parallel and wait for the result of all those functions. It's fan out, fan in. We won't be covering that in this challenge though. You can also wait for events in orchestration. And that's definitely what we will use in this case. And it also allows you to have very long running workflows and even eternal workflows. So they will run forever. And we will use a bit of that functionality as well. So if you're using .NET, here's the link to the Drupal task NuGet package, which you need to add to your solution. So you have the API to use to create these different types of functions. Because there are several different types of functions that Drupal functions exposes, and you'll actually use all of them in this challenge. So there are four types. I'll describe three now, and the fourth a little bit later. So the three major ones are client functions, orchestrator functions, and activity functions. So the responsibility of the client function is to start a new instance of an orchestrator function. So, and a client function is basically any type of Azure function. So it could be an HTTP triggered one or a queue triggered function, a service bus triggered function, anything goes. But it will have an additional binding. And that indicates it's a client function, and it will have a special interface, and that contains a method start new async, which allows you to create a new instance of this orchestrator function. Well, the orchestrator function is the most important one. In that orchestrator function, you define which activity functions you will call. You will define the sequence of them, and you probably have some additional business logic, which activity will be called in what circumstances. So it's really about orchestrating and scheduling different activities. And the activities, which are here, are really the functions that call to a database or call as an external API to get some data or to manipulate some data, to do calculations. So usually activities just do only one thing. So clients to create a new instance of an orchestrator. The orchestrator contains then the calls to different activities, and activities only have one responsibility for one specific functionality. Okay, so here's an example of an orchestrator function. So like any Azure function, it's just a method with an attribute, function name. In this case, there's a specific binding for Azure functions. It's an orchestration trigger. And with that, we have access to the iDrupal orchestration context. And there are a couple of methods on that context, which I will highlight here. For one, there is a get input method on there, because usually when you start an orchestration from a client function, you can pass in some information as an input parameter. And this is the way how you can get the information back. So if I start, if I want to start a new instance of an orchestrator and I pass it a string as an input variable, this is the place where you can then extract that input from the orchestrator. And the input that can be a simple type like string, but it could also be a .NET class, it could also be a POCO, as long as it's serializable. In this case, the orchestrator does function chaining, and we will chain two functions together. So the method which you use is call activity async. The function name which you are planning to call is then the first parameter. And in this case, I'm using name of and then a class name, because I always try to just have one function per class, so I can always reference the class name. So I'm calling the getPlayerActivity function here, and I'm passing it in a player ID. So this is the input for this activity function. I'm expecting the output of guest player activity, and the output is of type player. So it's the generic parameter here. So call activity async, we specify the output parameter, we pass in the name of the activity we want to call, and we pass in an input. In this case, we get a player object back, and we will use that player object in our second activity. So again, we do the call activity async. We don't expect any output here, so that's why there's no generic parameter here. But again, we specify the name of the activity, and we specify the input. And note that we do an await for these calls. So it's very interesting to know that the orchestrator executes. And when it is at this part, it will schedule the call to this activity. But then the orchestrator will stop. So it will not continue immediately with this call. So it will execute the activity, but then the control comes back to the orchestrator. And then it starts executing from the top again. So it's not like your regular C# that first I'm doing this call and I waited and then I'm doing this call. No, with an orchestrator and calling activities or waiting for events and things like that. The orchestrator runs up to here. Then the control will be handed over to this activity function. The orchestrator goes to sleep. Once this activity function is done, the control will be handed back to the orchestrator, but the orchestrator will replay from the top. So it will first read the input again, then it will check, okay, I'm doing this function call again, but since it persisted the state in the storage account, it knows that it's already scheduled and executed this activity function, so it can read the output from storage. So it will not call it again, and then it will continue with the second function. So I've tried I tried to capture this in this diagram here. So let's say you have an orchestrator with three function calls, or three activity calls. When it comes to the first one, the first activity will run and the orchestrator will go to sleep. Once the activity is done, and basically it also checkpoints the inputs and outputs in table storage. So when this activity function completes, the orchestrator will restart again. So it will not go directly from FA1 to FA2. No, it will restart. So that's what this number means. It will restart from the top, and then it will see, okay, did I already execute function A1? Yes, because I have some data in it in storage. That's fine. We'll reuse that data, and then we call the next function. Once it has completed that, the orchestrator will restart again. It will check, have I completed FA1? Yes. Have I completed FA2? Yes. Okay, let's move on to FA3. And then it will repeat. So it's very important when you start working with Drupal functions that this orchestrator will replay over and over again. So when you put a breakpoint in your orchestrator at the top, when you have several activities, now you will see that breakpoint being hit over and over again because of the replay nature of Drupal functions. All right, that's all about the orchestrators until now. Then activity functions. Like I mentioned, those are the smallest basic blocks, units of work of Drupal functions. Again, those are just, again, methods with a function name, but now they have a binding of activity trigger. You can use either simple types or POCOs, again, as input objects. It's always important to realize that activities only have one input. So if you want, for instance, now it uses a string, but if you wanted to use two strings in an activity function, well, you could actually use a user tuple, or you should make a new input object. So you can have a POCO with two strings, for instance. So that's important to realize. And in this activity, there you can treat it just like any other C-sharp function. Then you can usually use a service or a repository to call something else. The final type are the client functions. And like I mentioned, the client functions are built on top of any regular Azure functions. So in this case, I'm using an HTTP trigger function, but I'm also using this Drupal client binding to indicate that it's a client function. So in this case, I'm reading a string from the HTTP request, but here we see that the start new async method is used to create a new instance of this update player score orchestrator function. And I'm passing in the player ID from my request object as the input for the orchestrator. So there are a lot of more things you can do with your with a client function. You can also manage more about your orchestrator instance, but that's not really important now for this challenge. I have a separate section about entity functions, so we'll come back to that later. Let's now move to sub-orchestrators. So it's almost the same as activities, but an orchestrator can schedule calls to activities, but an orchestrator can also schedule calls to different orchestrators. So that can be very useful because maybe you have a piece of functionality, and maybe you have some kind of a small function chain that you can use as a reusable, repeatable unit. So you can use that as a sub-orchestrator. So you have some activity calls in your main orchestrator, but then you call a sub-orchestrator, which does a fixed sequence of other activity calls or waiting for events, for instance. The latter is what you use in the challenge. So this allows also a lot of new opportunities how you can use orchestrators and use and also orchestrators which wait for a very long time and how to wait for events. So this is a very, very useful feature. Just don't go overboard with it. Usually I only use two levels of orchestrators if I need it. So don't create really like say 10 levels deep of sub orchestrators all the way down because it won't be visible anymore what you're doing. So here's an example of an orchestrator which calls another orchestrator. So in this case, it's about a chaining of two sub orchestrators. So this is the method called sub orchestrator async. And for this orchestrator, collect player game stats orchestrator, we pass in a player ID and we expect a player game stats object back. And we use that player game stats object for the input for the other orchestrator. So the second orchestrator we are calling is the update player game stats orchestrator. So instead of having one very big orchestrator with lots of activity calls that has been split up into two smaller orchestrators, which are then chained together in this main orchestrator. The next part is eternal orchestrations. So eternal orchestrations are orchestrators that never finish. And they're very useful when you want to perform something in a loop. And so you have your client that starts an orchestrator and you do some activity calls where you do some waits in your orchestrator. And at the end, you use this method, continue as new, which indicates I'm not doing a simple replay like we've seen before. No, I really want to continue this orchestrator, but I'm forgetting about all of the execution history. I'm really starting as a new instance of this orchestrator. So what would be a good use case for this continuous new functionality is if you want to do some kind of periodic cleanup, for instance. So this is an example of a periodic cleanup orchestrator. So this is the orchestrator function. We read and clean input, clean up input from the context, which indicates we want to clean up some resource in Azure, for instance. We then call the activity to do the actual cleanup. So for instance, we want to maybe get rid of some VMs or clean up some disks or databases. But the result of this is an updated cleanup object. So maybe we this contains 100 resources to clean up. And when we do the cleanup, we find out we can only get rid of 80. So we have 20 left. So we have this updated items to clean up object that comes back. And then we check from, okay, are there any items left to clean up? If so, then, well, this is something extra again. Then we create a timer and wait for the timer to finish before we do the continuous new. So in this case, I'm defining a 4-hour wait time, which is the next cleanup time. Then I'm creating a timer. That's an, again, a new functionality of the orchestrator. So I'm telling the orchestrator, okay, you can only continue when this timer is passed. And when the time is there, then we use the continuous new functionality. And then we pass in the updated items to clean up. So that's very important not to, to use the original input, because that was the list of 100 resources. Now we pass in the list of 20 resources we get back to clean up again. So then this will continue as new. And then this items to clean up is now the list of 20 items. So it will do the cleanup activity again. And maybe this list is now empty. So it doesn't need to clean up anymore. And then the orchestrator will be finished. So eternal orchestrators, you can make the eternal part conditional. So that's a nice thing. Now let's go to events. It's also a big part of this challenge. So orchestrators have the ability to wait for external events. So a client function creates an instance of an orchestrator function, and that starts. But in there, you can mention wait for external event. And there you specify that you want to wait for a certain event with a certain name and a certain input type. And then the orchestrator will just wait there until it has received that event, and then it will continue. So how does it look like? In this case, we have an approval orchestrator. And we first define a timeout for 1 hour. And then we do the wait. We do a wait for external event. And we expect a type of Boolean. And this is the event name that we're waiting for, because also events are raised also by name. So we're waiting for an approval event of type Boolean. So this part, the timeout and the final argument, that's a default value, is always useful to add. So I would never supply just the waiting for the event name, because these are actually optional parameters. I would always supply them. Because if you say, okay, I'm going to wait for an external event of this type, of this name, and that event never gets raised, that means your orchestrator is just waiting forever. It won't do anything, but from time to time it will become active and it will check from, okay, has something been done? But no, nothing has been done. So it's always advisable to specify a timeout time and specify a default value. So once this timeout time has been passed, so in this case, once an hour has passed and we have not received this approval event, then the result will be false. And then the orchestrator will continue. So it's always good to have this timeout value and a default value when you're waiting for events. And then based on the events, you can have some additional logic in your orchestrator. So in this case, if it is approved, okay, do these actions. If it's not approved, do these other actions. So waiting for events is really a very useful functionality of durable functions. So that's waiting for events, but the events have to come from someplace, right? So they are raised from somewhere. This is very big. Let's make this a bit smaller. So events can be raised from a client function. And again, a client function can be any type of function, HTTP trigger, queue trigger, whatever. As long as you have that Drupal client attribute, then you can raise events. What is very important to realize though, here I have an example of an HTTP trigger function. It's a Drupal client function. I'm reading a approval result from the request. And here I'm using the raise event async method. What is very important to realize is that you need to raise an event to a specific instance of an orchestrator. And so a client is also responsible for starting a new orchestrator, an instance of an orchestrator, but also events need to be raised for a given orchestrator instance ID. And you need to get this ID from somewhere. So in this case, I'm receiving an approval result which already has that orchestration ID. But in case you don't have this orchestrator instance ID, then you need to make sure you store it beforehand and then read it back. And that's also part of the solution for this challenge. So you raise an event for a given orchestrator instance ID, and you also always use a specific event name, and then you have the event type. In this case, it was a Boolean. So the API is quite straightforward. The only trick is that you need this orchestrator instance ID. So this is the way you can use the Drupal functions API. Yeah? So you can use the iDrupal client interface and then the raise event method to raise events. But there's also a built-in HTTP API to raise events. So that's this link here. Okay, so the final theory part is about stateful entities. So stateful entities is more of a recent addition to Drupal functions. So first were only client functions, orchestrator functions, and activity functions. But later they added entity functions. And entity functions are functions that also have a state. But it's a bit of a different state than orchestrator functions, because orchestrator functions also maintain their state, but then it's more about input arguments and inputs and outputs of activities and orchestrators. But the state for an entity is really, entities have properties, and those can be persisted to storage. So it's more like an actor model. So entities can have state, and they also have methods to interact with the entity and to manage their state. There are different ways to interact with entities from either client functions or orchestrator functions. In this case, I'm only covering signaling an entity from a client function and a reading entity state from an orchestrator function. But there are more ways to signal or to call entity functions. But like I said, I'm only specifying the information you need to solve this challenge. So let's start with an entity definition first. So an entity definition, it's a function, but in this case, it's also a class. So here we have a class, player_entity. And that documentation says, use the JSON attributes and use the opt-in attribute to make sure that you have a lean as possible entity. So you only need to specify the JSON properties for the properties that you actually want to have serialized, you want to have stored. So I have a very basic entity with only one property, score, and I want to make sure that that is serialized to storage. So that's why I have this JSON property to it. And it has three methods, just two methods to interact with that state. So I can set a certain score and I can reset the score to zero. The final method is then the definition that this is an entity function because we use the entity trigger binding. And then we will use the arguable entity context with the dispatch async method to make sure we can actually interact with this player score entity from our client functions or orchestrator functions. What's also very important to realize is that entities always need to be accessed via their ID, and you don't see an ID in here. But there is an entity ID type, and that entity ID type is then composed of the entity name, so in this case player score entity, and a player entity key. And the key is totally up to you how you define it, as long as you make sure that it's unique for whatever you need to store. So in this case, a player score entity a useful key would be some kind of a player ID, for instance. So how can we then read state? So reading the state can be done like this. Like I mentioned, you first need to define the entity ID by combining the name of the entity and a key. In this case, we use the player name as the key, which we read from the query, the message body. Then we have this entity ID, and then we use the read entity state async method. And we define what entity we want to read, what type it is, and we specify the entity ID. Then it's always advisable to use the entity exist property to make sure that whatever entity ID you came up with does it actually exist. The result that you get back, this player score entity, that's not the entity itself. This is a entity state response object. And that contains the entity exist property. To actually get to the entity, there is this entity state property, and that's of type player score entity. So this contains our custom properties like score. Okay, then finally, how to update or set that entity state. In this case, I'm doing this from an orchestrator. Again, I'm defining an entity ID by combining again the player score entity and the player name as the key. In this case, I'm signaling an entity, and signaling is a one-way communication. And when you want to signal to an entity, you use the entity ID. You use the method name you want to use. And as you can see here, it's the string-based representation of the method name. So it's the set. I want to use the set method. And then you provide the input for that set method. So this is a way of signaling and one-way communication of using the set method on the entity and providing it the score. All right, back to the challenge. There we go. So I've covered a bit of the dual functions theory. It should be enough for you to figure out the challenge now. If you want more information, there's also some links to the dual function docs there. There's also more videos from me if you want to know more about how dual functions is handling all of the state and the control flow. Please read the requirements very carefully and come up with a design how you would design your function app with clients, orchestrators, activities. I've also added some tips on a separate page. So first try to do your own thing. Then if you have some trouble figuring it out, go to this page for some tips. All of the sources of the final solution are already in this repo as well. But yeah, I think it would be best if you try to figure it out on your own first, and only when you're really blocked, look at the solution. And the solution I will cover in my next video then. So good luck with this challenge. I hope it will be fun. You probably need a couple of hours for this thing. And yeah, let me know how it's going, please. You can always contact me on Twitter. So good luck, and until next week when we discuss the solution of this challenge. Bye.